Hello, and welcome to this presentation, Understanding NVIS. This presentation provides a short introduction to the fundamental technical principles of NVIS, or Near Vertical Incident Skywave, the most common types of NVIS antennas, as well as the reasons why NVIS plays an important role in HF communications. This presentation assumes a basic knowledge of HF radio propagation, including the structure of the ionosphere and both groundwave and skywave propagation. If you're unfamiliar with these topics, you might want to watch the presentation, Understanding HF Propagation, before beginning this presentation. We'll start our discussion of NVIS with a short review of traditional skywave propagation. Skywave is one of the most important HF communications modes because it enables beyond line of sight and even worldwide communications. In skywave, layers of ionized particles in the upper atmosphere refract HF signals back towards Earth, allowing communications over many thousands of kilometers. The distances that can be covered by different frequencies are largely a function of the state of these layers of ionized particles, collectively referred to as the ionosphere. One of these layers, the D layer, acts to absorb signals and helps determine the minimum frequency that can be used. The lower the frequency of a signal, the more heavily it's attenuated by the D layer. Another layer, the F layer, refracts signals to allow communications well beyond line of sight, and the level of F-layer ionization determines the maximum usable frequency. In addition to the amount and nature of F-layer ionization, the incidence angle, or the angle at which a signal reaches the ionosphere, also plays an important role in how far a skywave signal will propagate. The radiation angle, or takeoff angle, of an antenna is primarily a function of both the type of antenna and the location at which the antenna is installed. Higher placement of an antenna usually lowers its radiation angle. And generally speaking, the lower the incidence angle, the greater the distance covered by skywave propagation. Note, however, that so-called skip zones may be created depending on radiation or incident angle. In these zones, HF signals can't be received either via skywave or via groundwave propagation. NVIS, or Near Vertical Incident Skywave, is a special case of skywave propagation that enables both skip zone coverage as well as coverage in rough terrain, where groundwave or low-angle skywave signals might be blocked. NVIS is implemented using an antenna with a very high radiation angle, typically 75 degrees or more, transmitting on lower HF frequencies. The nearly vertical takeoff angle of these signals means that they're returned to Earth relatively close to the transmitter. Typically, coverage is on the order of several hundred kilometers. This range, combined with the easy setup of most NVIS antennas, makes this technology very well suited for applications that require ad hoc communications in possibly challenging terrain, such as military operations or disaster relief operations, where the existing communications infrastructure may have been damaged or destroyed. We'll start our discussion of NVIS by explaining the advantages and disadvantages of NVIS and how NVIS antennas are different from those used in traditional HF skywave communications. NVIS has a number of purely technical advantages. The first of these is that NVIS is more resistant to fading and provides a more constant signal level compared to traditional skywave propagation. Furthermore, the near vertical incidence angle of NVIS means a shorter path through the D layer and less D layer absorption. In addition, a shorter overall path length reduces attenuation between transmitter and receiver. Attenuation of the signal due to terrain is minimal or non-existent because there's line of sight propagation between the transmitter and the ionosphere and between the ionosphere and the receiver. This line-of-sight propagation also helps to reduce fading due to multipath. All of these factors mean that NVIS works relatively well at low power levels, which is particularly important for portable or battery-powered operation in the field. And as we'll see shortly, NVIS antennas provide roughly omnidirectional coverage. This omnidirectional pattern means that antenna orientation, or azimuth, is relatively unimportant, which in turn permits a great deal of flexibility in the setup and sighting of NVIS antennas. In addition to these purely technical benefits, NVIS also provides many operational benefits, particularly in a military environment. NVIS signals generally have a lower probability of intercept than conventional HF skywave signals. This lower probability of intercept comes from the fact that NVIS can operate at lower power levels, and also from its vertically oriented radiation pattern. Both of these make it significantly more difficult to DF, or use direction finding, to locate a NVIS station, particularly for ground-based DF stations. Remember that the energy from a NVIS antenna propagates upwards in a narrow pattern, and returns from the ionosphere with roughly equal strength over the coverage area. There's no strong ground wave signal component that can be used for taking a bearing. Conversely, it's also difficult to jam NVIS signals using a ground wave jammer. NVIS antenna patterns are designed to have very low or poor gain at traditional ground wave angles, and therefore will also not receive ground wave jamming signals as strongly. NVIS antennas are mounted comparatively low to the ground, making them discrete and difficult to notice. Being low to the ground also makes NVIS antennas easy to erect, and many can be set up by a single person. And finally, since the radiation angle is roughly vertical, there's no need to control the high ground to make effective use of NVIS. Obstructions in the horizontal plane, like trees, mountains, buildings, etc., are much less important than in traditional skywave propagation. There are, however, some disadvantages when using NVIS. One of the most important of these is that NVIS only works at lower frequencies. We'll discuss this in more detail shortly. The nature of NVIS antenna patterns and propagation also means that NVIS has a limited range, typically only hundreds of kilometers, compared to the thousands of kilometers that can be achieved using traditional low-incidence skywave communication. Furthermore, optimum results require the use of NVIS antennas on both the transmit and receive stations, although this requirement is somewhat looser for receive-only antennas. An additional potential disadvantage of using NVIS is the fact that both atmospheric and man-made noise tend to be higher at the lower frequencies that are used in NVIS communications. To make effective use of NVIS, we must choose frequencies that are low enough to be refracted by the F layer of the ionosphere when arriving with a very high incidence angle. Signals with too high of a frequency will simply pass through the F layer and continue on into space. NVIS also requires the use of frequencies that are high enough that they're not excessively attenuated by the D layer. Remember that D layer absorption is highest for low frequency signals. In order to balance out these two somewhat conflicting requirements, NVIS operation uses frequencies in the range of approximately 2 to 10 MHz. Like all other skywave propagation, the maximum and minimum frequencies depend on the level of atmospheric ionization, and this in turn depends on things like sunspot number or solar flux index, the time of day, the season, and any abnormal solar events. For example, during solar minima, the maximum usable frequency for NVIS may be only 6 to 8 MHz. On average, however, NVIS frequencies range from 4 to 8 MHz during the day and from 2 to 4 MHz at night, but as mentioned earlier, this can vary significantly. The specific frequencies used can be manually chosen by an operator based on experience and various ionospheric measurements, or the frequency can be automatically chosen using techniques such as automatic link establishment or ALE. NVIS is essentially an antenna technology, so we'll begin our discussion of NVIS by contrasting it with traditional HF skywave antennas. Most antennas intended for HF skywave communication are designed to have a low radiation or takeoff angle. This lower angle means a lower angle of incidence with the ionosphere, and hence longer distances due to lower refraction angles. In this application of HF skywave, an antenna that sends too much energy vertically is sometimes unflatteringly referred to as a cloud warmer. On the other hand, NVIS antennas are specifically designed and installed in order to have this high radiation angle, typically 75 degrees or higher, which means that the majority of power is going up instead of going out. As we'll see, there are a number of ways to do this, but the most common method is using an antenna that's located close to the ground. And just as with traditional skywave antennas, an antenna tuning unit may be needed when using a NVIS antenna, especially if the antenna is being used over a wide frequency range and or as a field expedient antenna. One of the best ways to understand the difference between traditional low incidence angle skywave antennas and NVIS antennas is to compare their antenna patterns. Since NVIS can be implemented as a dipole, we'll compare a standard HF dipole with a NVIS dipole. A standard HF dipole is usually mounted at a height that produces a relatively low elevation angle, as seen in the diagram on the left. The relationship between elevation angle and antenna height is somewhat complex, but generally speaking, the higher a dipole is mounted above the ground, the lower its elevation or takeoff angle. A lower elevation angle works well for long-distance HF skywave communications because we can achieve greater distances when the transmitted signal is incident to the ionosphere at lower angles. A dipole being used for NVIS is characterized by a much higher or more vertical elevation pattern, as shown in the diagram on the right. As we'll discuss shortly, the primary method for creating this type of vertical radiation pattern is by moving the antenna closer to the ground. This higher elevation angle is necessary for NVIS, but clearly would not yield satisfactory results if used for traditional long-distance Skywave communications. A half-wave dipole suspended at normal heights above ground for traditional HF Skywave communications has a directional pattern, with the majority of gain being broadside to the antenna, shown here in red. In a typical NVIS antenna, the azimuth pattern is roughly omnidirectional, meaning the orientation of the NVIS antenna is relatively unimportant. If we were to rotate the dipole orientation by 90 degrees, the azimuth pattern would remain essentially the same. The azimuth pattern of our NVIS antenna also shows that coverage is fairly uniform within the receive area. The NVIS antenna does not favor one horizontal direction over another. This is especially important in situations where the location of the receiving station is not known, there are multiple receiving stations, or when the receiving station is on the move. These are typical military and/or disaster relief scenarios. In these types of situations, a directional antenna pattern could be counterproductive, since there may be no reliable way to know in which direction the antenna should be pointed. NVIS describes a certain type of antenna, or more precisely, a certain radiation pattern or elevation angle produced by an antenna. There are, however, many different types of antennas that can be used or adapted to produce the typical NVIS antenna pattern. Given the most common applications of NVIS, so-called field expedient antennas, that is, antennas which are designed for portability and ease of setup, are often preferred. The most common types of antennas found in NVIS applications are dipoles and inverted Vs, which are a variant of the standard horizontal dipole. Unbalanced wire antennas are also used in NVIS. And there are also a number of different types of vehicle-mounted antennas. We'll discuss all of these shortly. Other types of antennas found are fixed-site applications, where low profile, portability, and/or ease of setup are less of a concern. These include conical spiral and vertical log periodic antennas. The standard half-wavelength dipole used widely for low-angle HF Skywave propagation can also be adapted for use in NVIS applications. A traditional Skywave dipole is usually positioned roughly half a wavelength above ground. In order to create a high radiation angle, a NVIS dipole needs to be much lower, usually around 0.2 wavelengths above the ground. For example, if the operating frequency were 7 MHz, a NVIS dipole should be erected approximately 8 meters above the ground. Generally speaking, the lower the active element, the higher the radiation angle. To some extent, the optimum antenna height is also a function of ground conductivity. The higher the conductivity, the lower the optimal height. Because of this, the use of an optional reflector element has sometimes been recommended, for example, when the soil has very low conductivity, such as sand or rock, or if the dipole is high above the ground. It does, however, remain unclear how much of an advantage this optional reflector provides, and in most cases, NVIS dipoles do not have a reflector installed underneath them. One final observation on dipoles. If a single dipole is used for operation over a wide frequency range, an antenna tuning unit is often needed. But a set of dipoles, or a so-called fan dipole, can also be used for NVIS applications to provide better matching over a wider frequency range. An inverted V is a variant of the horizontal dipole where the center of the dipole is supported by a vertical mast, and the ends are often close to or near the ground. A very common implementation of the inverted V in NVIS uses two dipoles, often positioned at roughly right angles to each other. This arrangement is sometimes referred to as a turnstile antenna. Using a pair of dipoles helps to overcome any polarization-related fading and enables use of circular polarization. One of the main advantages of an inverted V over a standard horizontal dipole is that this type of antenna is easy to erect. It has only one central support and therefore can be raised by a single person. When using an inverted V for NVIS, the apex or peak of the mast should, however, be kept low, usually only slightly higher than the height of a horizontal dipole. A lower height mast also ensures that the apex angle remains low, which is important for obtaining the desired vertical radiation pattern. Dipoles are balanced antennas, but unbalanced antennas can also be used for NVIS. An inverted L is one example of an unbalanced NVIS antenna. The name inverted L refers to the shape of the antenna. It's most commonly created by connecting a horizontal flat top to a vertical downlead. The antenna then works against ground, or against a counterpoise if necessary. Like most other unbalanced antennas, an inverted L radiates along its entire length if the radio is connected to the end of the wire. As we'll see shortly, Inverted L's are also a popular choice for vehicle-mounted NVIS antennas. NVIS antennas can and often are deployed on vehicles. Loops are a popular choice for vehicle-mounted NVIS antennas because they allow the use of NVIS even when the vehicle is in motion. The standard vertical whip antenna found on many vehicles is a poor choice for NVIS due to the nature of its radiation pattern. But this type of antenna can often be bent or tied into a horizontal position for use as a NVIS antenna. In this configuration, the best performance is usually achieved by tying the antenna backwards, that is, away from the vehicle. Bending the mast backwards has the advantage of reducing out-of-phase currents generated in the bodywork of the vehicle, but this also usually forces the vehicle to be stationary. The whip can be tied or fastened in the forward position, that is, over the vehicle, in order to allow the antenna to be used in motion, although at the cost of lowered efficiency and a less optimal radiation pattern. Generally speaking, a proper dedicated loop antenna is a better choice than an improvised loop antenna made by bending a whip in either direction. Here are some additional images showing mobile NVIS antenna implementations. The first is a loop-style antenna, in this case mounted on the deck of a ship. Another common NVIS antenna variant used in mobile applications is the so-called towel bar, as seen here. Towel bar antennas have the advantage of being low profile and sturdy, and a single towel bar is one of the most common methods of deploying NVIS on an airborne platform. A double towel bar arrangement increases the effective size of an antenna and therefore increases the antenna's bandwidth performance. Note that towel bar antennas can be implemented to operate as dipoles, loops, or inverted L-type antennas. One final general note about NVIS antennas. In addition to maximizing high-angle skywave signals, a NVIS antenna should also minimize any incoming low-angle groundwave signals. This is important because if a station receives a signal via both skywave and groundwave, the interaction of these two signals can lead to destructive interference, distortion, and/or fading. Minimizing groundwave signals also has several additional technical and operational advantages. Most noise sources are typically close to the ground, so minimizing groundwave reception can also reduce the impact of these noise sources. Similarly, minimizing the reception of groundwave signals also reduces the effectiveness of groundwave-based jamming. And since a well-designed and properly installed NVIS antenna radiates most of its power upwards, there's much less power that can be detected and located by ground-based radiolocation or direction-finding systems. Let's summarize what we've learned. NVIS, or Near Vertical Incident Skywave, is a special type of skywave propagation that uses antennas which are designed and installed in order to produce very high elevation or takeoff angles, typically 75 degrees or more. Unlike traditional low-angle skywave signals, the signals from a NVIS antenna are returned for the ionosphere almost vertically, and this is what gives NVIS its main characteristics. The first of these is that NVIS can provide coverage in so-called skip zones that can be created by the lower elevation angles used in traditional skywave communications. NVIS is also useful in communicating within areas where groundwave is impractical, such as mountainous or jungle regions. The roughly omnidirectional coverage pattern provided by NVIS makes antenna sighting and orientation less critical, and also facilitates communication with mobile stations or with stations whose locations are not well known. In addition, it makes NVIS well suited for use with temporary or field expedient antennas. From an operational standpoint, using NVIS decreases probability of intercept, complicates ground-based direction finding, and also provides greater immunity to groundwave jamming. The main challenge when using NVIS is that it only works well at lower HF frequencies, typically in the range of 2 to 10 MHz, with a maximum frequency being a function of time of day and current solar conditions. NVIS is an antenna-based technology that can be implemented using a variety of different antennas. One of the more commonly encountered categories of NVIS antennas is one or more dipoles mounted close to the ground, either horizontally or in an inverted V configuration. Unbalanced antennas, often inverted Ls, can also be used, and there are various types of loop antennas which are particularly useful in vehicle-mounted or mobile applications. This concludes our presentation, Understanding NVIS. Thanks for watching.